Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Breath of heaven. Breath of heaven, breathe. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him, without the Word, was not anything made that was made. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water, and God said, let there be light. Some of you in this place today need the Word to breathe on you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Kids, you are dismissed today in the presence of the Lord. If you have your Bibles, and you will, turn to the book of Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. We will begin reading in verse number 23. We're going, if the Lord is willing, to begin a new sermon series this morning talking about the restoration of the years. Joel chapter 2, beginning in verse 23. Be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For He has given you the former rain moderately, and He will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. Hold your finger right there, because I want you to understand what that verse means. It means up until this time He has given you the rain to come down just as He willed it to be, and He gave you the rain a little here and a little there. But this verse says that when in this season He's going to give you the former rain and the latter rain together, and you're going to get it in 1 month's time. All the rain that has been and all the rain that shall be, you shall get in 1 month's time. That's a lot of water. Verse 24, and the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fats shall overflow with wine and oil. Verse 25 is our text for this series. And I will restore to you the years the locust has eaten, the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Before you're seated today, I want you to turn around to somebody and tell them God is getting ready to restore your years. And when you have done so, you may be seated today in the presence of the Lord. Verse 25, we have heard this passage of Scripture, but most of the time we have heard it quoted out of context. And I have been guilty of it, and you may have been guilty of it too, but we will always tell people, don't worry, God is going to restore the years that the canker worm has stolen. God is going to restore the years that the locusts have stolen. The problem is, locusts don't steal anything. Locusts just come in waves, and when they come, they do what is natural to them. They devour. They didn't steal anything from you. They were just doing what they only knew to do, and that was devour. The Word does not say that He's going to restore to us the years that the locusts have stolen. Because in order to say that the locust has stolen it means that they thought in their mind, I'm going to go down to so-and-so's house and I'm going to steal what rightfully belongs to them. No, no, no. The Lord is going to restore the years that the locusts have devoured what God has always intended for you to have. And now as we are studying this passage in this series, may I tell you that when it says that he's going to restore the years, it does not mean that if you're in your 60s, that if you have lost a lot of things for 25 years, that God is going to somehow restore years on to you. No. What's going to happen is God is going to take everything that you've lost, and in a moment of time, he is going to restore everything to you that has been robbed from you, that you have cost yourself, that you have lost over the years. And some of you ought to be doing jumping jacks, cartwheels, and somersaults because some of you have been cheated for a very long time, or so you think. And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten. I am going to give you everything back. And there are some people who have taken this passage of Scripture and who have made whole doctrines out of this passage that if you have ever lost in your life, don't worry, God's going to restore to you 100-fold. The problem is, in my life, it hadn't worked out that way, but he's always been faithful, and I've always been happy, and I've always had joy, because the joy of the Lord is my strength, not his provision. I have been through things in my life that I have to tell you, most of them are things of my own making. And the first thing you need to understand today is that the devil is a defeated foe. The devil's not coming in and robbing you of anything. If the years are stolen from you, more times than not, it's because you've made all the wrong decisions and you've cost yourself, and the locust has come and the locust has devoured your sustenance. We have something today called poisons that you can get rid of locusts. Back then, they did not have those poisons. And so when you saw the locust on the horizon, you knew some things. You knew that they were getting ready to, if you had any crops, they were going to come on your field and they were going to light on your vegetables or your olives or whatever it was you were growing, and they were going to devour it. Now, what you need to also understand is this affected more than just your harvest this year. They could not go down to their local hardware store and just buy a packet of seeds. They were responsible for getting their own seed out of their own harvest. We're all the time wanting people to give us seed. We treat church as if it is the local hardware store, and all we gotta go do is go down to the hardware store and buy a packet of seeds. And if somebody will give us seed, then we will have a harvest. If the praise and worship team does what they're supposed to be doing, then we're going to have a harvest. If that pastor gets up and he's not a jackwagon today, we're going to get a harvest, you see. If he says all the right things and does the right, all the right voice inflections and moves his hand when he's supposed to move his hand, then we're going to get a harvest. And what you do not understand is you are responsible for your own seed. Waiting on somebody to give you seed when God is waiting on you to bring your seed. Oh no, hear this pastor, he's talking about money. No, that has just been perverted. Every time we talk about seed, we're not talking about money. I don't want to get too graphic with you today, but for my children to be born, it required a seed. See, we're not talking about money now. Now we're talking about sex. Those of you who don't like me talking about money, fine. We'll just park on sex for a while. How you like me now? For my children to be born, for me, for my wife to have given birth to our children, there had to be some seed. And without the seed, I would not have had children. The church of the living God is plagued by devoured seed. By devoured harvest, and we have no seed with which to give birth with. Thus, a life of barrenness will only produce whining and griping and complaining. I know, and you have to understand that I know, that when people begin to gripe within the church, they're not griping about the church, they're not griping about the worship team, they're not griping about the building, they're not griping about the pastor. What they're griping about is their barrenness, and they're unhappy because they have no seed. And if they have no seed, then they have no harvest. God has created us as His children to produce. God has called us as His children to produce. There are ways that we produce, and I don't really want to get on a lot of them today, but we produce by faithfulness. We produce by the way we live our life. You're never going to be a mean old snake and bring somebody to Jesus. Everybody's talking about the gifts of the Spirit. What I want to see in the church is not more gifts. What I want to see is more fruit. I wouldn't give you a plug nickel for somebody who can talk in tongues but are mean, but are meaner than anybody you've ever met in your life. When the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. I don't want more gifts. We got enough of those. Listen, I went to, what was that we went to last night? Rockin' Worship Roadshow. They sang some of the songs our worship team sang today. And I'll tell you this right now, they didn't do a better job last night than our worship team did today. I was there, I know. We have enough gifts. What we don't have enough of is fruit. The Apostle Paul said, I thank my God that I speak in tongues more than you all. But in the church, I would rather you speak 5 words that I could understand than 10,000 words that I could not understand. And prompted him to write 1 Corinthians chapter 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. As you're walking down the hallway talking about your brothers and sisters in the Lord, you need more fruit, not more gifts. Hey! You need more fruit, not more gifts. You mean old snake, you mean old battle axe, you need more fruit, not more gifts. You have the gift. Everything that is ever, everything that is ever going to be given to you has already been given to you. For you understand in the book of Joel, the passage that we read, the Bible, this is a prediction of the upper room experience where the disciples were in one accord, of one mind, and they were seeking the face of the Lord. And on that day in the book of Acts, God gave the former rain and the latter rain together, and your young men. Oh, let's just go ahead and read it, verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my Spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord. That passage of Scripture has already been fulfilled in the upper room experience. The gifts and the callings of God are without repentance. The question is, why don't you operate in the gifts you already have? And I'll tell you why you don't. You don't operate in them because you don't have the fruit of the Spirit. You already got the gift of the Spirit, but you don't have the fruit of the Spirit. Love, you don't have it while you're talking bad about everybody and their dog. Joy, you don't have it when you come in here looking like you sucking on a green persimmon. Is that all right? you're 40 and over, you rest assured you know what I'm talking about when I say sucking on a green persimmon. If you're under 40, you're looking at me like a calf stares at a new gate. You got no idea of what we're talking. I remember the first time, and my daddy's here today, I remember the first time he cut a green persimmon off and said, "Here, son, suck on this." And I don't know if I was saved, but if I wasn't saved, I'd have probably cussed him out if I could have opened my lips. "Here, son, suck on this." "Okay, daddy."
"Thank you very much."
Come in church looking like you sucking on a green persimmon. You have no joy. Now, the fruit of the Spirit is peace. You worried about everything and everybody. You don't know, come here from Sikkim. You don't know how you're going to make it another day. You refuse to fall in line with the Word of God and just rest on Him and cast your care on Him because He cares for you. Long suffering. The reason you don't experience a harvest in your life is because you give up right on the brink of your breakthrough. You have no long suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, self-control. Against such there is no law. Please understand this morning that this is only the introduction to the sermon series. But you need to understand that they did not have in Israel a hardware store they could go to and buy more seed. Their seed came from their harvest. And when the locust would come and devour it all, it meant that they not only lost this harvest, but they lost the harvests that were to come. Haven't you ever felt like that? Just everything you touch is turning to garbage. "I'm just trying to do the best I can, Pastor. And I am trying to sow where I can sow. And I'm trying to do this and I'm trying to do that. And everything I touch, it just seems like it's nasty and it's dirty and it's filthy." I know, because you're trying to pretend you have seed. When your seed has been devoured, your harvest has been ruined, and your sustenance has been devoured. Yet in verse 25, he says, "And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten." Locust in Scripture is often associated with the judgment of God. The judgment of God, when the judgment of God comes upon you, there is nothing you can do about it. When a door is opened by Him, a door is opened and no man can shut it. But when God shuts a door, no man can open it. There have been times in my life that I have toiled and I have spun and I have worked and I have pleaded and I have begged in my life, "Oh God, what's going on? Everything that I'm touching is turning to garbage. I'm not happy. I need this and I need that. Oh God, I need something in my life." The locusts have come, God, and they have destroyed my sustenance. Oh God, and not only have they destroyed my sustenance, but I know, I hear all these yahoos standing behind pulpits that tell me I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath, and that you have only the best for me. But God, it just doesn't seem like I'm living my best now. Do you know why I came to church this morning? I came to church because I need a miracle. If you came to church for any other reason other than you need a miracle, you came to church for the wrong reason. But I don't need anything. There is some thought that in the book of Revelation, where Jesus was talking to the church at Laodicea, he said, "You think that you're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, yet I see you as poor, miserable, blind, and naked. If you walked into the door today not recognizing your soul dependence upon the Creator of the universe, you are here for the wrong purpose. If you're here to bless us with your presence, you are here for the wrong purpose. If you're here to get seed from somebody else, you're here for the wrong purpose." Now, I'm not saying that everybody in this place is in the same level. Some have been called higher and deeper, and others are more shallow, and that's okay because God is calling deep to deeper. Do you know if I step in a puddle and it comes to my ankles, that may be deep to me. God does not see that as shallow. God sees that as deep. But what he does is he calls those who are in their ankles or up to their ankles, he calls them to come out a little further to their knees and then their waist. God is tired of watching his people being devoured by locusts. And what God is after today is he wants to devour you, not the locust. In the book of Acts, chapter 3, I'm going to go there today. Brian, I did not give this to you, but I did not know for sure if I was going to get here. We have preached on this passage of Scripture before, but I think that, by the way, that was the introduction to the message. Now we'll move on to the meat of the message. And we'll get to our first point today, and probably only our first point, and then we'll continue next Sunday. Acts chapter 3, we have talked about this passage before, but the Lord has just laid it upon my heart, and I can't get away from it, so we're going to talk about it again as it proves, I believe, the first point of how in the world does God restore the years that the locust have eaten? If locusts are associated with the judgment of God, if you will read in Joel chapter 2, God says, "I'm going to restore the years that the locusts have eaten." You will notice that right before he says that, he tells the man of God to call the people to a fast and for the people to repent. God can never restore to you until you first realize, "I'm the man, I'm the one who cost me. My grandma didn't cost me, my grandpa didn't cost me, my cousins didn't cost me, nobody cost me, I cost me. I made decisions and I made choices, and it wasn't anybody else's fault, it was my fault. And I've got to turn and I've got to go the opposite direction of where I am, because if I don't turn and go the opposite direction of where I am, I shall never have the years restored unto me." That's next week's message, and I don't want to get on that. But this first one is a whole lot more simple, and we find it in Acts chapter 3, beginning in verse number 1. "Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate." Say daily.
Daily.
"They laid him daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful." In other words, it is the Horaios gate. If you were here for this teaching, it was the Horaios gate, meaning the beautiful in timing gate. It was the beautiful in timing gate. It didn't mean that the gate was ornate and beautiful, but it meant that God had a specific time and a specific thing and a specific season of what, when, and where he wanted to do what he wanted to do. Thus, they took this man daily and they laid him at the Horaios gate, the gate which was called Beautiful. But the King James Version just doesn't get it right. It really means beautiful in timing. Now, if you're watching today and if you're here and you're a King James only individual, bless your heart. Because the King James Version didn't get it right. It was not the beautiful gate. It was the beautiful in timing gate. And when it was translated, King James translated it, the beautiful gate, which gives us this idea that it was ornate and that it was beautiful. No, it was beautiful in its timing. And so here this man lay from his mother's womb every single day. He didn't get up on Monday morning and say, well, I got a headache. I'm not going down there to the gate today. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. You're not shouting because you know where I'm going. He showed up every single day. A motorcycle didn't get in his way of him showing up. The lake didn't get in the way of him showing up. After all, he couldn't have went to the lake if he wanted to. He was crippled. He was lame. The problem with most people is they don't think they need nothing. How do you minister to people if you minister to them only when you're full? Only when everything goes your way. Only when everything is going right. How do you minister to people? The answer is you don't. And we find that people are in ministry a lot of times for their own needs to be met, not somebody. Oh, is that all right? They live from the gospel and not for the gospel. Why am I the pastor of the Link Church? Why am I a Sunday school teacher in the Link Church? Why do I do this? Why do I do that? And if we were honest, most of the time people would have to say, well, I hold the position in the church because I want people to think I'm spiritual. I won't follow the direction. I won't follow the plan, but I just want people to pat me on the back, and I love the title, and I want the title. And so now I can go down to the grocery store, and I can tell people, glory to God, I'm the pastor of the Link Church. Bless God. They laid him at the gate every single day. He never made an excuse for why he could not get to the gate. He just got to the gate every single day because he knew something that we did not know. He knew that the gate was not called beautiful. He knew that the gate was called beautiful in timing gate. And he was looking for somebody and something to do a miracle in his life. If I'll go down to the beautiful and timing gate, somebody will pass by and they'll throw me a quarter. And if I'm really lucky, they'll reach in their pocket and they'll pull out a dollar. I'll stand on the street corner with a sign that says, we'll work for food. Have you noticed they have abandoned that for the most part? Oh, don't get me wrong. They still stand on the street corner, but they don't have signs anymore that say, we'll work for food. Because I've tried to give them a bunch of jobs, and you figure out real quick they don't want to work for food. They're happy and they're satisfied with your proverbial dollar. Because do you understand, if they get 100 people to give them a dollar, they just made $100 that day. And then tomorrow if they go and they get a dollar, I know this isn't politically correct. I get it. But nevertheless, it's true. I have tried to give hamburgers to people. Hamburgers that I had not yet eaten off of. I've listened to some people say, you know, I got halfway through a hamburger, and I tried to give it to them. They must not be hungry because they didn't receive it. If I was hungry and you tried to give me a half-eaten hamburger, I wouldn't eat it either. You nasty thing. I've tried to give them hamburgers that I hadn't even eaten off of, and they wouldn't take it. You know why? Because they're not hungry. And my fear is, ladies and gentlemen, that we come to church as poor little paupers, and yet we don't even know that we're hungry. We don't think we need timing for anything. So here's number one. If you want God to restore the years that the locusts have eaten, you have to show up. If you don't show up, God cannot bless you. Hello. Well, I've never. Well, maybe somebody should have told you this a long time ago. Well, I know I'm unfaithful, and I know I'm this, and I know, but God understands. And then you're setting appointments, and you're saying, I don't understand what's going on in my life. I don't know what's happening. I don't know. I do. You don't show up every day. By the way, this is not a message on church attendance. This is a message about an everyday walk with God. You don't show up. Your church attendance is because you don't show up every day. You only want to show up on Sunday, as long as it's convenient. We don't need more gifts. We need more fruit. We are about to go into this season of prayer, and I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, this is the prayer for this church, that God would open our eyes, and the worship team sang about it this morning. God, make us aware of your presence that's already there. If you walk into church and you're waiting on the doodads, and you're waiting on this feel-good stuff, and you leave church and you didn't leave different than what you came, don't you get on the phone to somebody and say, well, God didn't show up today, because he's here. The problem is you're not aware that he's here. Is that all right? He's here. God, make us more aware of your presence. Let us forget about ourselves for a moment, and let us concentrate and focus on you. Make us aware of your presence. But here they laid him daily at the Horeos gate. He was lame from his mother's womb. He didn't even let that be an excuse. He'd call his aunts, his uncles, his cousins, his friends, whoever he had to call. Would you carry me to the gate today? I don't come to church because I don't have a ride. Why don't you call somebody? We giving rides all the time. My wife gave somebody a ride this morning. It's all right. We'll give you a ride. We just want to be a part of your life that much. What excuses do you use? They carried him daily to the gate, the Horeos gate, the beautiful and timing gate. And when he saw the men of God, Peter and John, about to go in through the gate, he held out his hand and he begged for alms. Meaning, he said, give me some money. I'm sitting here at the Horeos gate. I'm sitting here at the beautiful and timing gate. And will you just give to me because I'm showing up every day. Peter and John, those yahoos, said, bud, we're not cutting you a check. Son, we're not going to cut you a check to pay your light bill. We're not going to cut you a check to pay your rent. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. That's King James Version. But what they actually said was, not that we don't have any money, we just don't have any money to give you. We don't have any money to give to you, but what we do have to give you, we're about to give you. As Peter began to speak, the man gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. You can always tell who your friends are. And who they are, by who expects something from you. Verse 6, then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the Horaios gate, the gate called beautiful in timing. And they were all filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. Isn't it just like Christians? God moves and we're so dumbstruck that he did it the way he did it. Man gets healed of cancer. Wasn't expecting that to happen. Charles Bowen, when I first started hanging around him, he would take my hand and he'd put it on somebody's head that had a splitting headache, and I'd watch the headache leave. You could tell it on their face. They came down wincing in pain, and you would pray over them and pray for them, and all of a sudden the headache would leave, and I'd be like, wow, that is so awesome. And he said something to me one day that I will never forget as long as I live. He said, there is coming a day in your life where you will go, that's just God. Yep. Not that you won't be excited about it, but you'll come to expect it. Why? Because you'll show up. You'll spend time with him. You won't just come to church on Sunday waiting on God to do something miraculous, but you'll spend Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday in his presence. If the only time we seek his presence is on Sunday, we shall never have his presence in our life. If you desire the years to be restored, you must show up. One of the lamest excuses, I think, for not coming to church is I don't feel good. If you'll get to church, call for the elders of the church, you'll leave feeling better than what you came. Now, if you got the flu, call the elders on Saturday night and we'll come pray for you so you can come to church well on Sunday morning. Don't come up in here spreading your germs. Ain't nobody got time for that. We'll come to your house. We'll anoint you with oil. We'll pray over you. And the prayer of faith will save the sick. And by the way, if we ever get a phone call for the elders to go anoint somebody, and you refuse to go about 3 times, you will no longer be an elder. That's your job. That's your job. Peter took him by the right hand and said, "Get up from there and walk." What would have happened that day had he not shown up? But Pastor, I have been coming to church and I've been showing up and I've been waiting and I've been waiting and I've been waiting and nothing's happening and I don't know what's going on. You keep telling me that the Lord's going to restore the years that the locusts have eaten, and I just keep showing up and I keep showing up. Hey, you didn't show up last week when God wanted to do it. Just show up. Growing up, I used to hear the old Free Will Baptist preachers say, "You gotta be at the spout where the glory comes out." And you know what I found out? They were right. I came on Wednesday night. I came in here. I was pale. I was feeling so bad. I was feeling so nasty. And sat on the front pew. Pastor Nate thought I was mad at him. I just wasn't feeling good. But I showed up to God's house. And I have to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that when I left here feeling different than what I did when I walked in the door. And I get home. About midnight, I hear from my daughter's bedroom, "Daddy, daddy, 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 daddy," and she's puking all over her room. I stayed up with her all night on Wednesday. But I did not stay up all night wringing my hands thinking, "What am I going to do?" I laid hands on that baby girl and I said, "In the name of Jesus, this will stop." Come on. And I prayed all night long. And I watched her as she groaned in agony and pain. And I watched as she threw up all over my man cave. Oh, why did I ever put her up there? And I prayed. The next day I prayed. I was feeling so much better. I thought, "Man, I can't wait. I'm going back to the church on Thursday. Been out all week being sick, and I'm so tired of being out of the church." And guess what happened? She gets sick, and I don't get to come on Thursday either. And I'm sitting at home, and I'm wiping her brow, and I'm kissing her on the cheek, and I'm praying over her. And it went from throwing up every 30 minutes to on Thursday, she was throwing up about every 4 hours. And I kept praying. Thursday, Stephanie gets home from work and she comes in. "How's baby girl feeling?" I said, "She's feeling good, better than what she was. She's thrown up about every 4 hours." She said, "Well, that's good." And I said, "Yeah, it is." Stephanie said, "Well, I'm taking off work tomorrow." And I said, "Well, thank you, because I'm beat." Stephanie took off work on Friday, stayed up with her on Thursday night. She didn't vomit one time, didn't vomit all day Friday, didn't vomit all day. And I thought, isn't that typical? Didn't vomit all day Saturday, hadn't vomited today, feeling good, singing to the top of her lungs. She was singing to the top of her lungs on Friday. Puking on Thursday, singing on Friday. I told you that story to tell you. God is able and faithful. And shall do what he said he would do. But baby, you got to show up. You can't sit at home on your laurel of do nothing and expect God to work in on your behalf. Now, can you prove that in Scripture? Yes, and I'm getting ready to close. Yes, I can. Go back to Joel chapter 2. I didn't give you this, so you don't have to put it on the screen, but you ought to have your Bibles. Joel chapter 2, verse 12. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn you even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your heart and not your garments. And turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. And repent him of the evil. Who knows if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priest, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. And let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and give not your heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is your God? Don't you ever feel sometimes that the heathen around your life are asking you the question, oh yeah, where's your God? I'll tell you when they'll know that your God is real, and that's when God restores the years that the locusts have eaten. But in order to get there, you have to show up. And you have to repent. Show up and repent. Well, I just don't like it down there at that Link Church. Then please find somewhere where you can show up. Your life depends on it, ladies and gentlemen. Well, the music's too loud. I understand. You ought to have been at that concert last night. I thought it was interesting they were giving out earplugs at the door. I thought, man, I feel like I'm at church. Because we do that here. If it's too loud, stick you some earplugs in. Just don't gripe that it's too loud. And then when you stick the earplugs in, don't gripe that it's too soft. Because you understand, and I'm closing with this, I promise. You understand that the excuse of the music being too loud is only an excuse, right? You understand that, well, he preaches too much on tithing. You realize that's just an excuse, right? It's an excuse to not show up and then put the blame on somebody else for not showing up. And people are huge in that arena. Don't do what you're supposed to do and then blame somebody else for you not doing what you're supposed to do. Come on. my grandma and my grandpa hadn't done what they did, then I would have shown up. That's only an excuse. Blaming somebody else for why you don't do what you're supposed to do. Well, the church is full of hypocrites. Ooh, I know, and you're the biggest one. Oh, I'm sorry. And I'm the biggest one. Is that better? I don't want anybody leaving offended. The church is full of hypocrites. I know, I am one. And so are you. We might as well just show up together and be hypocrites together and love on each other. People sitting in judgment for other people being hypocrites. Okay, I gotta say it. I heard this the other day. Saw it on Facebook. I hate Facebook. Saw this on Facebook. Homosexuals sitting in judgment of Donald Trump because he's a sexual pervert. I just looked and I, what? They learned it from the best. They learned it from the church. Church sitting in judgment of sinners while they go out and sin. Church sitting in judgment of the adulterer while they themselves are unfaithful. Because after all, isn't sin sin? Recognizing that we are all sinners and just showing up anyway because we don't want to be is the key to having the years restored. Well, I'll forgive it, but I'll never forget it. Then you didn't forgive it. And I have come to the Link Church this morning, and if you're watching, listening to the sound of my voice, I want you to understand today that God is about to show up and show out in your life, and He is about to do something that nobody ever thought possible. There are some relationships that are about to be restored that nobody ever saw being restored because we love one another and we forgive one another, and when we forgive, we forget. Well, how do you forget? You choose to.
That's right.
If you didn't forget, you didn't choose to forgive.
That's good.
And if you choose not to forgive, then you choose not to be forgiven.
Right.
Well, I don't think that's even scriptural, really. The Apostle Paul said, forgetting those things which are behind. Oh, here he goes. He's bringing out the word again. He's bringing out the word. Well, I don't know how I'm going to forget. You choose to. Forgetting those things which are behind and pressing forward from here. And God is about to restore relationships that nobody ever thought could be restored. God is about to restore finances that you never thought He could restore. But you first have to repent. Whew, got quiet on that one. If, and listen, I think it harsh that we have said this passage of Scripture for so long that we have allowed it to grow cold within our heart. But nevertheless, it is the pinnacle and the secret of our success to not only forgive others, but to be forgiven. And that is, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves. In order to forgive somebody, you first have to humble yourself, understanding that you're no better than the individual that you have to forgive.
Amen.
Well, I ain't done the same things they done. I know, but sin is sin. Humble yourself and pray and seek my face and turn from your wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven. Then will I forgive your sin. Then will I heal your land. And some of us in this place need to be healed. And I don't mean physically, I mean spiritually. We have been hurt and we have been decimated and we have been destroyed. Yet God has remained faithful. So now, He wants to restore the years that the locusts have devoured and eaten. It does not mean that He's going to add years to your life. But it means He is going to restore those relationships.
Come on.
Listen, He's even going to restore, you can call this prophetic if you want to, He's going to restore your destiny. He's going to restore your call because He never repented of it. The gifts and the callings of God are without repentance. He promised that He would go with you to never forsake you. No matter what you've done, no matter what's happened in your life. But here's what happens in life. We come to these places. We find ourselves discouraged. Whether it was an act that was perpetrated on us by another human being, or whether it was an act that we ourselves perpetrated on ourselves. And we now find this roadblock in the road. And now, because of discouragement and defeatism in our life, we allow the enemy to do all kinds of things to us. But whether you're watching today or listening to the sound of my voice in this sanctuary, I am here today to tell you that the Holy Spirit of God, that which you feel on the inside right now, is the Holy Spirit of God wooing you to His side. That He wants to restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. And if you will but call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. I've already been saved, Pastor. I know, but you've been discouraged. And now you've had this roadblock and you've not walked out your destiny. You've not walked out your calling. I am here today to tell you that God wants to restore that destiny and that calling that He had upon your life a long time ago. That the roadblock came and hit and now has robbed you for years and years and years. God says He wants to restore your destiny. In Jesus' name, would you stand to your feet in this place? Father, we love you today. We give you the glory and the honor that is due your name. We know what your word says. We know that you are about to restore to us the years. Not the moments, not the days, not the weeks, not the months, but you're about to restore the years that the locusts have devoured. We ask today, oh God, that you have your will and you have your way with us in this place. And we'll be careful to praise you and give you the glory for it in Jesus' name.